Good afternoon, everybody. I request Mr. Amit Kumar, Senior Director, Social Transformation, TERI, to please come on dais. I request all the speakers to please come on dais. Mr. Kartik, Wahi, Co-Founder and Director. Mr. Rustam, Sengupta, Chairman, Boond, India. Ms. Shubhra, Mohanka, Managing Director, Ms. Shubhra Mohanka, Managing Director, Gautam Solar Private Limited. Mr. Vijay Bhaskar, Country Director, Milda, India. Mr. Vijay Bhaskar will be joining us soon. I request Mr. Amit Kumar to preside over the session, please. Meantime, Mr. Vijay Bhaskar will be joining us.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. So post lunch, I think people are more engrossed in still partaking the lunch. But I am very happy to see that in this expo we are also covering off-grid, because off-grid has somehow become unfashionable of late. Especially when we are talking of 24/7 supply to all by 2022. It's but natural to think more seriously about what is the relevance of off-grid. Now the point is that while we are talking of electrifying all the villages and households by way of grid extension, are you also going to make sure that those households are also being supplied electricity and reliable electricity? Now even today, India is surplus as far as electricity is concerned, but we still have a situation where millions do not have access to electricity. So that's the dichotomy one is talking about. And what's the reason for that? In fact, last week there were power ministers conference, and one of the issue which was being talked about is that though government is going in full steam to supply electricity to everyone, villagers in many places are not willing to take the connection and to pay for what they think is a recurring expenditure. So under the circumstances, do we really think that in time to come 24/7 electricity is going to happen with grid extension only? Also keeping into mind the fact that financial health of most of the DISCOM is very, very poor. So that has an implication of especially supplying electricity to such far-flung and scattered places, that too which most of them would have very low load capacity. So that means supplying electricity over hundreds of kilometers just to meet few kilowatts of demand. So that means for a utility that would be a very financially unviable proposition. So why would they do that? Government under its social obligation can definitely insist on that, but we know that even today in cities, utilities resort to load shedding rather than buying electricity, because more they supply the electricity, more the losses are. So then those are the ground realities which we have in India. So to me personally, and that is something which I was talking to Shubhra just now, that even if we say that we are going to have electrification, 100% electrification, the relevance of renewable-based such system would not go down. What I would definitely, of course, say is that probably we should not be talking about off-grid solutions, rather distributed systems, which as and when grid extend and you have surplus power can definitely be hooked to the grids and can start supplying surplus electricity to the grid. So I think the narrative would change, but the essential elements of what we talk today in terms of our grid system would still remain. But then that is my personal belief. And fortunately, we have very good panel having good mix of practitioners, social entrepreneurs, and those who are actually working so much at the ground level. So rather than I talking about such things and expressing my personal views, I would rather see that we get advantage of our panelist. And to that end, I would first request Shubhra, and at the stage which I have reached now, most of the people are younger to me. So I don't have to go into Mr., Mrs., Doctor and all. So I can very well call you all of you by first name. So Shubhra, floor is yours, and we would like to see that what are your views on this topic.
Hello. So my name is Shubhra Mohanka. I'm from Gautam Solar Private Limited. We are basically a solar off-grid player and distributed solar player, as sir rightly put it. With the competence in manufacturing of the entire spectrum of solar off-grid. So whether it is solar panels, solar batteries, or solar electronics, solar plastics, solar structures, we make everything in-house. So we are a manufacturer and system integrator of solar off-grid and distributed solar systems. One of the things that we have started feeling is that with the objective of 24/7 electrification, even if there is a real need in villages of continuous and reliable power, because it's written in government papers that this is 24/7 electrified, you will not get any funds for solar off-grid or distributed solar there, basically. Here I'm talking more about solar home systems, solar mini-grids, micro-grids, we had a statement from Honorable Minister Piyush Goyal Saab, which said ki only 4,000 villages need to be electrified, which will get electrified by 25th September, etc., in next year. So when you have these kind of statements coming in, then you can absolutely forget that any work is going to happen in solar off-grid apart from those 4,000 areas. As a manufacturer and as a system integrator, it's extremely challenging if you're working in that kind of an environment. Keeping that aside, the future that I see, especially when you're sitting in the Smart City Expo, is threefold. The first one is when we are looking, so right now grid-connected distributed rooftop solar is something which the government is focusing on, which the smart city also is focusing on, that a certain percentage of energy has to come from solar. Grid-connected rooftop solar power plants is one of the solutions that the government is promoting, and most of the work is going to be happening in that area. But wherever this kind of work has happened, till the time solar was contributing 1%, 2%, 3% energy to the entire mix, it was fine. But as soon as the mix started touching 30% to 40% of that energy requirements, the grid used to destabilize. This has been seen in Germany, US, all the countries that are a bit ahead of the curve in terms of the rooftop solar power plants, have all moved to rooftop solutions with battery storage backup solutions. I mean, if you look at Tesla, if you look at Germany, all of them have got an equivalent number of people. I mean, the focus is as much on energy storage and battery backup based solutions as much as on solar. And I think that is where we need to move from a solar industry perspective. We have to move to solar with battery backup solutions. It is more relevant in India because we do not have continuous power also, like the way they have it there. Because A, it will save us grid destabilization. And B, time of day concept is definitely going to come here in India also, where the power that you produce in day, that you get in your day is going to be more expensive than the power that you get in night. So grid connected solutions with battery backup, so which we could categorize in distributed solar or off-grid, is going to be the way forward. But because the focus right now is only on grid connected solutions, and the driver is actually the amount of subsidies the government is giving, so they are not really accepting it right now, but that is where the future will move ultimately. Number two, the place where I see the role of off-grid or distributed in smart cities, and I think we see a lot of examples in exhibition halls also, is your solar street lighting and solar high-mast street lighting solutions, where we are centrally controlling all street lighting and giving power and doing that. So you could effectively do it because solar is a decentralized solution. You could have solar high-mast solutions, solar street lighting. It's beautiful for campus, economically also it would be a good solution to have. And now with coming of age of lithium ferrous integrated street lighting, the battery theft etc. issues are also not going to be there, and it's going to be more it's going to be more effective for the thing, because the lithium ferrous battery and the lithium ferrous integrated street lights will typically last longer also. So that is the second place where I see the distributed solar application. And third is where I'm sure, I mean, Kartik would be a better, this thing would be your solar pumping solutions. So whether it is community, societies, etc., wherever solar pumps can play a role, and wherever water, wherever taking out of water, water treatments, water purification, in these places I believe that solar has a very good future. Again, distributed solar perspective, a lot of new models are getting tried also now with grid-connected solar water pumping, etc. coming into play, and without subsidy models also coming into play. So this is the third place where I believe off-grid and distributed solar is going to play a role.
Thank you very much, Shubhra. In fact, you brought forward few very relevant points. One was you talked about reliability. I think reliability is something which is probably one of the drivers of solar systems. Because today also all the consumers, whether those are in urban areas or are in rural areas, want reliable electricity supply. And when I say reliable, what I mean that the quality of supply at the time you want it and on consistent basis. And this is something, in my experience, and definitely in rural areas, is something a grid is not going to fulfill, at least in next few years to come. And that's the gap a well-designed solar system can very well meet. The second point which Shubhra brought about is talking about different devices, different off-grid or standalone devices, which can be actually very well fitted into overall economy of the country. And solar pump is a good example, and so are other devices. And that led me to wonder as to, should we be thinking also about those old-fashioned solar water heating systems and solar cookers, which have totally gone out of vogue now because everyone is talking only about electricity. So that again is something for us to ponder upon, that when we talk of off-grid solar solutions or when we talk of solar sector, are we covering the full spectrum or not? So anyway, let me now come to Mr. Rustam Sengupta, who is chairman Boond India. I don't need to introduce Boond. Rustam is a social entrepreneur, and I think his view would be very, very interesting.
Thank you, sir. Thank you to the organizers for the invitation, and good afternoon to everybody. My name is Rustam Sengupta. I am the chairman and founder of Boond. Boond has been working for now about 8 years in the off-grid areas. We started with Lake Shubhra, who I have huge respect for. We started with home systems, lanterns, microgrids. We also set up mini grids, water pumps, so whole kind of services in Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan. So I think a lot of good points have been already brought up. Just to sort of summarize my perspective, there are three basic reasons why off-grid will survive, even if there's a different kinds of political or economic mandates. Number one is because India still has close to about 56 or 60 million households without electricity. And when we talk about these households, the interesting thing to note is these are not all the same place. These are not always, a village which is defined as off-grid is electrified. We are talking about maybe 8% of a village not having electricity. Maybe a certain community in the village not having access to electricity. So this is all spread out across the country, spread out across different villages, different social strata. So a way of reaching these, or actually reaching people inside a particular village who, for whatever reasons, are not being able to connect the grid, is an off-grid solution, is a solution which is more like for built for his home, built for his payment capacity. Number two is how do we cover the arbitrage of supplies? Now, Sarkar ke liye, for the government, putting a pole in a village, making a big statement might, you know, classify as electrifying a village. But electrification in real terms or electrification for being valuable has to be at least 20 to 22 hours a day. It also should be at least of a certain voltage. It has to be of a certain level of technology that you can utilize it properly and create value. Now, are we there? Will we be there even if we have 100% villages with a pole with a wire coming in? Well, the guess is for anybody to make, but I have yet to see a government program that can do that in this short period of time. So while there will be a pole in a lot of villages, I highly doubt or I highly would think that would there be 24/7 power. So that creates another business case for off-grid, which is a supplementary energy source, which is very important to understand, because when we talk about villages, we are talking about people actually living there who have a generational requirement for solar. So even if the government provides 6 hours, 8 hours, 10 hours, there is rest of the duration which can be plugged in. The third key requirement of solar, which is now growing, is very industry specific. Specifically, I think Kartik will talk about it more, is agriculture. If you look at agriculture, you'll see Indian agriculture is heavily under mechanized right now. It's also heavily, you can say, non-automated. There's a lot of lack of metering. There's a lot of lack of agricultural machines running to full efficiency. And primarily one of the biggest reasons for that is most things are running off diesel. Most things are running on very shantily shared power connections. And that industry alone is, we calculated it sometimes, about $60 to $70 billion in nature, if that can be captured. And that the energy that's right now provided to this sector is also heavily subsidized. So that alone is a huge driver for these off-grid or, like sir mentioned, decentralized systems to grow. So these are the three key drivers which still inspires people like us to keep penetrating the industry, inspires wonderful people like Shubhra or Kartik to keep building new products and entering the industry. And I think it is also fairly acknowledged by the government. It's always been financially difficult to have companies in the off-grid sector. It's always been a challenge because you are working with a battery which you are installing very far from the service station. So your cost of servicing has been fairly high. It's always been very difficult because the people who you work with in these areas are fairly untrained. It would be fairly impossible to have a room full of so many technicians in some of the places like Unnao or Hadoi where we work in. Whereas the requirements are the same. To run a power plant in a place like Delhi or to run a power plant in a place like Unnao requires the same engineering expertise, but people are not there. So the challenge is always there. But along with the challenge, there is opportunities. And I'll also mention now three application opportunities that we look forward. The first opportunity we look forward to is the access of energy into livelihoods. So there have been a strong amount of livelihood supply chains in rural India that I noticed, and we've been doing some work on, which are really inefficient because of the lack of electricity. I'm talking about weaving clusters. I'm talking about carpet makers. I'm talking about people in tanneries, people in milk collection centers, chilling plants. So many. If you really look through it, it's an amazingly, unbelievably big industry, which are working below their capacity, which could use help from decentralized. So that's going to be the next big thing to grow in this industry. The second thing that you'd have to watch out for is the level of automation and the level of metering. So as you develop more IoT techniques for smart grids, and which seem more obvious, there's going to be a strong level of monitoring requirement, strong level of metering requirement in this sector, and that is something to watch out as the second product that could grow. The third product that will really grow is how you can increase, like Shubhra mentioned, storage. And how you can involve better storage, maybe lithium ion, but not also be able to reduce the cost of them. So I was just in Europe last week, and we also came across sodium batteries, which are huge in size, but actually half or one third the price of a lithium ion battery. So there is a lot of work, a lot of research which is going into storage. And I think that would be another strong driver, another strong field in renewables, in off-grid, that we all need to watch out for, and that inspires us to go on. So that's what I'll conclude with as our starting comment. But I think it's a sector which has always been difficult. So people sitting in this room should never feel that any time we had an easy time or the government actually gave us a free run to do. It's always been tough. It's also tough, but the market still exists. And there are enough applications that you can consider.
Thank you, Rustam. And first of all, thank you everyone that everyone is actually finishing before timer. So, but again, just like Shubhra, you also brought out certain very pertinent points. I think the whole rationale which you defined for off-grid system as a mean to reach out to those communities and those people who have not been able to be served so far by conventional means, I think that's a very interesting and pertinent point to note. Also, you also again reiterated on the fact on the reliability of the supply, and I think energy storage, what we are talking about, would be a good way to realize that kind of reliability, because then you would be able to supply at non-solar power also, and more dispatchable kind of supply. The point about complementing the grid, that is something is need to be more discussed at level where policymakers are also there, because they must also realize that how they are going to make their conventional grid system more reliable and from the consumer perspective. So recently TERI itself set up 240 kilowatt gasifier each in two of the backward villages in Odisha, and both of these villages are actually electrified, but they are getting electricity not more than for 5 to 6 hours a day, and that too they don't know when. So what we did was, and we purposely chose these examples, because we thought that if in time to come we are going to see a system where your so-called standalone system need to be grid ready, let's try that out. And also from the regulatory perspective. So we went through the regulatory commission route. We got the distribution utility and transmission utility on same platform. And Odisha Electricity Regulatory Commission passed a tariff order that yes, distribution company of that locality would take care of this. So we will supply electricity whenever it is surplus from gasifier to the utility, and then it would be utility's business to supply and collect tariff and everything. So we are not creating a duplicate system over there. Of course, these are very early days, so we have to see that how the these experiments progress, but at least we have made that beginning, and that's what probably you meant by complementing the grid system. So that again is very important aspect. And yes, agriculture and other rural industries which so far have not been served that much, because focus has always been providing even basic needs to the people. So I think those are the kind of things probably would create more and more and more viable opportunities for standalone and decentralized application of solar energy. So since we are talking of agriculture, I think it's high time that I turn to Mr. Kartik Wahi, who is co-founder and director of Claro Energy. Kartik, please.
Thank you, sir. If the session is about sort of, you know, validating whether there is a future for off-grid, or, you know, how meaningful or how scalable or how big would that be, I think the very fact that you have, you know, three entrepreneurs who are pretty much as old as the solar industry, you know, sitting in the same room. In fact, I think the joke is on us that he's probably, like, you know, been on, you know, several forums, the three of us, countless number of times, and running three, I would say, moderately successful but profitable, you know, ventures, you know, for that long a span of time, and still going strong. I feel, I think it should dispel any doubts for those of you who wish to pursue opportunities in this sector. Just to give you some context about us and, you know, where I come from, while obviously Shubhra did a, you know, gave a good background from the product side, Rustam painted the entire spectrum of, you know, off-grid in terms of how things have been happening, you know, at Boond and otherwise. We are a company which has, you know, sort of over the last 6 years primarily focused only on water pumping as an application. And it wasn't a very obvious choice for us. You know, obviously we, you know, did evaluate a bunch of things, and you know, as a young company, we made a few mistakes and eventually zeroed in on this particular application. But the rationale was fairly strong that the demand for reliable electricity or energy for running irrigation pumps was just extremely strong back in 2010 and 11 when we were like evaluating, you know, a bunch of these things. And you know, we chose not to be a product company but actually a downstream company, in the sense that we spent the next 5-6 years till date on building last mile capabilities to acquire these, again, very remote, rural and dispersed consumers who obviously have a very different way at you know, evaluating their sort of, you know, buying decisions, and then, you know, building abilities to go and install these systems again in very, very far flung areas with the same consistency that you know, for each installation for that fact. And then building a robust backbone of a last mile service support network, because, you know, unlike, you know, what popular perception might be about solar, but there are maintenance issues, and you know, maintenance issues might not be in terms of breakdown of solar panels or something like that, but there is sort of, you know, usual, you know things going wrong, maybe like, you know, water ingress or dust ingress or, you know, a rodent or just mismanagement, and someone needs to be able to go to the site, diagnose what the fault is all about, and then rectify it. For all that I could say, over the last 6 years of just doing solar pumping, I think we've, while the solutions have become fairly mainstream, we've barely scratched the surface. An interesting, you know, thing that I'd like to point out is that while the national narrative on off-grid primarily revolves around household electrification, and while that's a great thing to talk about, oftentimes I think the policymakers, you know, treat productive end-use applications, and irrigation is probably the most obvious one of you know, them, as a stepchild, which is why it's always sort of, you know, a laggard when it comes to the policies being first made for rooftop solars or you know, programs, or for say street lighting or LED bulbs or efficient lighting, and then, you know, pumping obviously. But it is sort of, you know, coming into the mainstream. When I said we barely scratched the surface when it comes to tapping the opportunity or solving the problem, I kid you not, I think, you know, even after 7 years of, 6 years of doing this, you know, I'm surprised with new data being thrown at me every other month. Last month I was told that, and from again fairly credible sources, that even for a state like Gujarat, wherein, you know, one would expect that they've had, they've been far, probably more progressive when it comes to agri-feeder separation, you know, the total number of pending applications for three-phase connections, which is what is required to run an irrigation pump. A conventional single-phase, you know, connection does not really work for a high-capacity, you know, irrigation pump. Even in a state like Gujarat, which has had the Jyotirgram Yojana, which has had, you know, feeder separation and apparently an assured 8 hours of three-phase electricity, about 3.5 to 4 lakh pending applications are there with the GUVNL, the utility there. Of farmers who want three-phase connections. And GUVNL obviously does not have the financial or the organizational capability to give out or, you know, extend more than, say, 80,000 connections a year. And apparently that's the same number of people who get added to the wait list every year. So in so many ways, that despite supposedly being a power surplus state and despite having an agri-feeder separated for agricultural loads, they themselves are, you know, very actively looking at or evaluating solar pumping as a very viable alternative. So whether you look at it from a policymaker's perspective or you look at it from a consumer's perspective, which in this case is a farmer, who will anyways have to shell out a ton of money to get a new three-phase connection or is already relying on fairly expensive diesel, the economic rationale is fairly compelling. And till date, I kid you not, it's probably no more than 70,000 solar pumps have been deployed in the country, you know, wherein, you know, depending on what source you're looking at from you know, at sanctity of data standpoint, there are close to almost 2-2.5 crore tube wells in the country. So, you know, we've not even a drop in the ocean right now, if I were to say that. So, yes, the opportunity is there, and yes, obviously, you know, off-grid is going to be relevant. Obviously, there is going to be confusion. I wouldn't say that the last 7 years have been a walk in the park. They've been fraught with challenges. And I think that will be the case with any new industry. You know, there is confusion at the policy level. There is, you know, the banking industry has not really sort of, you know, embraced this sector the way it should have, you know, by now. But things are improving. Similarly, the consumers have at least sort of, you know, started looking at solar pumping and other off-grid solutions as mainstream solutions that they can rely on. And business models are evolving as, you know, there are economies of scale or the industry collectively reaches a critical mass. So I feel that largely, you know, I take comfort in the fact that the macro indicators towards off-grid in general and solar pumping in particular are fairly strong and compelling, and obviously, you know, this industry is moving towards maturity, you know, and is only going to continue to grow. So, I mean, if I were to sort of sum up, you know, the introduction essentially, I'd say that, you know, have absolute faith in the opportunity, have absolute faith in the fact that even if there is grid electrification, which, you know, as Rustam pointed out, even if the khamba or the pole comes to the village, it does not mean that everyone in the village will have all their electricity needs met by, you know, that infrastructure being set up. Which sort of, you know, paves way for opportunities for companies like us to have, you know, a relevant play in the industry.
Thank you. So, Colonel Bhaskar is not here? Okay. So, I think we have ample time for question and answers. We should take full advantage of three young entrepreneurs being here and see how we can learn from them and share experiences and knowledge with them. But to start with, I have a question to all three of you. Because there is always that conflicting view as far as paying capacity of rural people is concerned. And I am focusing right now on, when I say off-grid means rural people. On one side, in many cases, we have seen that enterprise has to be shut down because villagers were not ready to pay for the electricity or the lighting that they be provided for. Saying that this is an expensive proposition. But we also have cases where villagers are paying actually exorbitant charges when on per point basis from DG set those mini-grid people, enterprises are providing electricity to them. So what in view is the reality? Is it more to do with reliable service versus unreliable service, or what are the reasons where, because of which we get so divergent views and experiences? And then as we move forward, where do you see that more and more robust and viable business models could be actually brought out? So, all of you.
I'll take the first stab at this. So, you know, just to give you an example, I feel it's incorrect to generalize the purchasing power of the rural populace. You know, you have all spectrums. I mean, you know, you obviously have the small and marginal farmers, wherein, you know, for them, you know, just sort of, you know, getting by with their incremental energy needs, you know, in this context is how things have been going about for them for, you know, a while now. And then on the other hand, you have the, you know, the affluent farmers, the large landholders, who obviously, you know, for them, you know, any kind of a capex, you know, as high as you and I can possibly imagine is not an issue. And then there's the entire range in the middle. Just to give you a very real example, you know, in a place like Bihar, wherein I think you would probably, you know, perceive that it's largely small and marginal landholding, you know, we're currently, you know, executing certain solar pumps under a government subsidy program, which requires the farmers to put in their contribution, which stands at 95,000 rupees. In the last 5 days alone, because the scheme was about to end, at least the phase one was about to end, in the last 5 days alone, we've probably just seen about 50, 60 farmers, you know, with very little effort actually come in and, you know, put in 95,000 rupees, you know, and in the form of a demand draft. Now, obviously, that's serious money for the farmer. But the question that we have to ask is not that, you know, whether the farmer has the ability, or at least a certain section of farmers have the ability to put in, you know, towards the upfront capex of the system or not. But it is more in terms of, you know, how he wants to really kind of ensure that he gets the best bang for his buck. Is he investing into a piece of technology that is likely to sort of, you know, withstand the test of time and the promise that it sort of comes bundled with, which is, let's say, you know, reliable or free or on-demand access to electricity for, say, however number of years, whether it is 15, 20, 25, you know, is subjective. Whether the fact that if there are any breakdowns, you know, is someone going to come to his remote village, wherever he might be, and actually, you know, address the problem. So it's more a question of that. And then obviously on the other end of the spectrum, when you have the small and marginal guys, one has to, and I think the onus is on the industry to essentially come up with, you know, more creative and new business models, which are more OPEX oriented, which are more pay as you go, help those, that spectrum of farmers to essentially benefit from off-grid or decentralized, renewable energy devices. So I feel that it's a fallacy when it comes to, you know, generalizing that, you know, farmers will not have the purchasing power. You and I will be surprised, by some of their decisions, because for them it's a question of access. Either they have it or they don't.
Those are excellent points. I'll just build on what Kartik just mentioned. Of course, there's whole different kinds of willingness to pay kind of customers in a village. I think the importance of this sector, as Sir also mentioned, is developing the right business models and the right pricing strategies for capturing the liquidity that's there with the different segments. So I think one of the things that the off-grid sector has done really well, and just to bring it out, is we've managed to segment customers really well and understand them. So you can see three companies, three in the same sector, but have a very different customer segment. I think in the rooftop, they're much more blinder than us. They just, go to the person and pitch the same thing. So here the customer segment is fairly mature. I'll give you an example. So we were in UP and we found the same thing, that people had a harder time paying. So there was two models that were tried out, and I'm sure all of us did that. One was pretty much going to the bank, getting the loan for the end customer and helping the end customer buy your product and pay it over a period of time. It's a tried and tested model, tried in the south, tried outside the country, and that helped. But then we found that, there were still some customers who did not even have the credit, the credit credibility in short to get that kind of loans. So we created, when we started doing our microgrids, we started creating our meters to be prepaid in nature. And we realized that a lot of people would like to, have the same percentage budget for buying electricity, that they want to have control over. So what we noticed is a very high willingness to pay. And we did a study with Columbia University, which came out that the willingness to pay significantly increased when they knew that they did not have to, they were not forced to give certain amounts of money over a period of time. So we took it another step forward. We said, look, so what is the inherent problem that we addressed is when somebody takes, we put the same grids in places where electricity was already there. And we noticed the same effect. We actually had a better result in places where electricity was there. The people were more willing to come and buy power. So we tried to understand it. What we found is one of the things that's very unfair with grid power in villages is you always pay a fixed cost. So aapko 200 rupees to dene hi, you have to pay the 200 rupees. Uske upar it's variable. Right? That's how our billing does everywhere. What really happens is that you do not even get electricity worth of that fixed cost. So that is something what people in the villages started thinking in their minds, and they told us that boss, light to aati nahi hai. I mean, 2-4 ghante light aati hai, to main 200 rupees ka meter kyun lagaun? So what we immediately said is we started a campaign which we said, batti band to paisa band, which basically means if we cannot provide you power, your meter will stop. It's prepaid. So you don't have to pay when there's downtime. Immediately, it was very interesting, and we did randomized control trials with academics. We found certainly there was a huge willingness to pay increase right then, because it sounded more fair. It sounded that we could navigate that little income willingness to pay by just saying this minimum statement that when there is downtime, you don't pay. If for a month my grid is down, they pay 0-0. But that's not the case with government power-based power. So that was, these are models to capture these kinds of willingness to pay. The second is, I don't know, Kartik, if you do that already, but how we remove the price from electricity to price for something which has higher value, for example, water. So a lot of companies in some places are actually not charging you for the kilowatts that you are providing them for the water pump, but actually the water that you produce. So how many liters of water? 1 liter, are you ready to give 50 paisa, 15 paisa, whatever? So what that immediately does is moves the focus away from the electricity, which, people start comparing with the grid or here and there, to something which has a higher value. And we've tried that with livelihood cases as well. So hooking it up with something like that. So I think what the point I'm trying to make with these examples is sometimes it's
more important to be innovative in creating your business models, innovating in understanding how to capture the willingness to pay, which makes things sustainable and, like you said, makes us address the different markets. And definitely an exercise of doing the right customer segmentation, understanding what is the income cycle of these people, how seasonality of income affects them, what is the liquidity, what is the saving profile, is something which is very important, which might not be necessary in utility scale. And we are just joking, where all you have to do is think what will happen 15 years later, go to Germany, get 2 percentage point finance and just bid 2 rupees 20 paisa. Or very soon we'll have free power plants. I'm sure I'll see that day. So we'll give money, and very soon it'll be like, please take my money and my solar panels. This is not going to happen in this sector, hopefully. Thank you.
There are two, as a company, we have tried two places where I saw successfully that there was an ability and there was a willingness to pay in rural consumer. One was the work that we did with TERI itself, in fact, the Light a Billion Lives project, where the village level entrepreneur guy was putting a 50 lantern charging station. He was getting part subsidized and part financed by banks. And then he was giving out the lanterns on a 5 rupee to 10 rupee kind of a bracket on a per day basis to the end users, and who were taking it, and then they were giving it back to the guy to recharge it and then give it back to him again. So basically, so you got hold of one guy who was having a local setup, who had a 50 to 60% ability to invest, and that time it was a 1.5 lakh kind of a system. I'm sure the prices would have come down now. And there he was investing, so he had some interest in the business, and then he was earning money based on the per day kind of a thing which was happening there. That was one model which I found was very successful, and I'm sure with the lowering of solar rates, we could again engage those kind of a stuff. So it had a right mix of a social, a grassroots person who was connected to the village with an ability to charge money from them and collect money from them. The second place where I found it successful was, it's not a successful one now, but it was successful. That one time was the NABARD scheme, in which the banks were, this was an MNRE program in which the banks were given a certain percentage of subsidy. So let's say if it was a 100 rupees product, 40 rupees was coming from MNRE and 20 rupees was to be put up by that beneficiary, the guy, the farmer who was taking that loan, and 40 rupees again was given as a loan to him. So 60 rupees in effect was being put up by the beneficiary himself to pay. What it did was, A, it brought down the cost of the system, through subsidy, through lower upfront capex, and B, through loans. Unfortunately, the subsidy was again dilly-dallying a lot, and though it was every time that it became too successful, you know, we started doing numbers, the government realized that, you know, the subsidy was way too much to be given, and then it withdrew back. But what it showed was that, you know, if you have a right, if you could lower the upfront costs of solar, which is now happening naturally due to crashing of solar panel rates, but also reduce that capex through loans, through subsidy, through a lot of things, then the people really want to pay. And so not really want to pay, they are able to afford the system much higher. And then, of course, there are farmers who could pay the entire thing upfront also, but with the coming of financial networks like a bank or an RRB or an MFI, the economics started sounding more logical to people. If they had to pay, let's say, only 50,000 upfront for a XHP of solar pump, you will get a larger bracket of people coming to you. So that is what happened. Today, if you ask me, in urban areas, if I have to buy a home, if I have to buy a car, if anything which has got a larger capex, how many of us can afford it if we do not have banks to support us? So a similar condition is there in the rural areas also. There, unfortunately, the number of people who can extend that loan, the regional rural banks network or the MFIs, they're all constrained and they're all a lesser number. And in lack of any schemes which are going, or as I put it, a scheme which is coming in and going out, we have not been able to formulate a policy for financial networks to freely give loans on these things per se. And we keep disturbing the financial networks by either wavering of farm loans, by giving subsidy, taking it back, So we are disturbing that system. I'm sure if we allow that systems to stabilize for some time, in which banks can play a role, in which more type of financial institutions can play a role, be it NBFCs, be it MFIs, I'm sure the willingness to pay factor will definitely come in, because solar at the end of the day is a higher capex. So if we could reduce that, and I'm sure that those things can happen.
Thank you, Shubhra. So now floor is open for questions. It would be helpful if you please identify yourself and also direct your question to whichever panelist you wanted to.
Hello. Yeah. So I'm Sudhir from Secure Meters. We are in the electronic metering, including the prepayment metering as mentioned by Rustam. My question is, how do you see the opportunities for the DDG schemes, like say distributed generation schemes? It can be off-grid and later on it can be connected to the grid also. And particularly the point, I think Rustam mentioned somewhere that in the remote areas, how to operate that, I mean, will not having the manpower. So more requirement will be coming from the remote monitoring and remote control. So one point is written here, like the digitization of distributed system. So my question is to, what is the opportunity in the DDG scheme? And what is the thing, throw some light.
Sorry, sir, I didn't get your name.
Sudipto.
Mr. Sudipto, I think I am very optimistic about things like remote monitoring, things like being able to have some kind of IoT capabilities in the meters. Because one of the things that operate sector faces is the distance, like you brought up, the lack of infrastructure, the cost per acquisition and cost per service. So I think that field is really growing. There are a lot of companies which are all international companies which are trying to build cloud-based application linked meters and stuff like that. So very optimistic. I think what has not happened there is the government has still not started acknowledging it as an industry in specific, because I think it's a separate industry which is catering. There is movements. A lot of us, ourselves included, have been going towards and trying to champion it. I think there has to be a... The criticality is there has to be a minimum amount of data that has been generated from these kind of devices, which we have not reached. As people like you and me who are trying to champion this, we have not yet reached that. I think we know in the off-grid sector how hard it is to, you know, network with the government. We have to show them a lot. So one of my goals and also suggestions is that we start working collaboratively and try to get numbers into the game, so that we have terabytes of data that we've captured, which allows some kind of forecasting, some kind of predictive logic, some kind of IoT control over it, which has value to people who want to monitor systems, especially in the water pump scheme. This is a very, very big topic in how remote monitoring works. And I was just talking to Shubhra after this, the health of the system is also very important. So I am very optimistic. I mean, love to talk to you after this also. We're very optimistic. We're also starting to invest into companies which are doing this primarily. And the government is still about 2 to 3 years away, so we'll have to bear with that.
I mean, from a solar water pumping perspective, again, it makes tremendous sense. You know, it's a no-brainer coming to think of it. Two benefits, obviously, I think, you know, as mentioned by Rustam, one is the ability to do remote fault diagnostics, right? So the cost of sending someone to diagnose and then coming back and then the rectification, I think every trip obviously has, you know, a cost which obviously gets passed on to someone in the value chain, mostly the customer. The government in the pumping sector has anyways been sensitized in the sense that most programs now and even the specifications which are, you know, given out by the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy mandate the use of, you know, remote monitoring systems for diagnosis. The problem there is only on account of implementation. It's one of those things that wherein there is a big disconnect with how the policies are worded and whether if at all anyone is actually even able to kind of understand, you know, if systems are being deployed. So it's only companies who themselves are sensitive about the fact that they want to provide for the customer in terms of having a very short turnaround time on any fault or a service request that gets raised will be the ones who will be seriously investing into building and deploying these systems. I don't think there's any dearth of companies who have product offerings off the shelf now, you know, that are available, I'm sure including secure meters. But it's just a question of the intent and the willingness of companies to really truly use that, you know, device, you know, for a diagnostic or a, you know, mining a lot of data and then doing some analytics around it. Secondly, obviously, you mentioned about prepaid metering, which again becomes very, very relevant as, you know, business models evolve. Whether it is, you know, systems which are being shared between a cooperative or systems which are pay-as-you-go or systems which are, you know, feeding into the grid, all kinds of metering requirements will be there, prepaid, postpaid, all of that stuff. I think Rustam really, you know, hit the nail when he said that. I think the metering segment has to still hit that critical mass wherein it becomes extremely relevant for everyone to see the benefits of, and from there I think it should, you know, most obviously take off.
My name is Suresh More. My name is Suresh More. I came from Mumbai. I'm an installer for the solar panels. And as a separate category, in Mumbai, in the terrace of the societies, there is very less space. And the problem we are facing that the amount of power generation is required for the outside lights and some water pumps and like this. So it is not catering the need of the society. So that the societies are not ready to invest on the monies. That one problem we are facing, that is the space of the panel equivalent to the energy produced. That one problem we are facing. Second problem we are facing for the industries. They are asking and they are worried for the life of the batteries. So the batteries are after, so okay, you are giving the guarantee of panels for 25 years, but the batteries after 2-3 years, it is a recurring cost for me. And we are not able to answer for them. We told that, yes, it is AMC and blah, blah, blah. We used to convince them and we used to move from there. And they are asking for what are the subsidies from the government. Because as the entrepreneur, they are interested for what money we are getting, what we are getting the advantage for. So what are the basic thoughts for that? It will be helpful for us.
So let's say if you have less of rooftop space, there are two kinds of solutions which are happening right now. You can't do much actually. I mean, you can, what you can do is give them up, the percentage that you can work on is plus 20% of what you are offering right now. So there are two solutions to it. One is a monocrystalline solution in which in the same area you could give at least 15% more power in the solar module. So let's say I had a customer in Okhla. He again had the same issue, small industrial area, and he was hell-bent on deploying 100 kilowatt, and he had 835 square meter roof area, and which was again having boilers and tankers and whatnot, because everybody uses his roof to the full capacity in Delhi. I'm sure the same would be in Mumbai also. So there were only two things that you could do, and for that the customer has to be paying you. One is you could elevate the structure and you could extend it as much as you can. That is the first thing. So we put it actually at a height of, I think, 30 feet or something. So it was a very, very, it was a really complex work that we executed. The second is that you start using today, you have got 325 to 340 watt panels, which are in the same area that you would have for a 300 watt panel. So, and if you go mono, if a ready customer is ready to pay 1 or 2 rupees per watt extra, you can go for mono panels. These are the two things that you could do. Around plus 20% is what you are going to get out of the entire thing. But the customer has to pay for the elevated structure and to pay for mono panels, which you'll have to see whether he's ready to do it or not. The second part of the question was industries. I'm not sure what kind of industries you're going to. Generally, because industries typically have more kind of energy requirements than what their rooftop has. So typically, the kind of industry that I experience is around 30 to 40% of power is what you are able to supply through solar. But if you're still saying that they want a battery backup, see, MNRE has been giving 5 years warranty from I don't know when. So 5 years warranty you need to give whether your battery can give it or not. And today I think if you see some of the solutions, lithium ferrous, lithium, and again the customer has to be extremely paying. 5 years you have to keep as a recurring cost. Lead 2-volt cells you can easily give 5 years. I don't think that should be an issue because these are mature technologies which are getting used in telecom sector, industrial sector. Lithium ferrous and lithium ion is something that again are good technologies and work is going on, but they are more expensive technologies. So I would think that there you would have a larger lifespan, 7 to 10 years. But again, as soon as you will tell the cost, I don't think the customer will invest into it. So these are two things.
Sir, I am also Kumar.
Sir, I'll just finish. Subsidy nahi hai. There is no price.
he can claim accelerated depreciation 24%, the 40% in the first year, 40% in the second year, and rest straight line. And that is sure. The government will never have subsidy for private anymore. So, wo zamana khatam. Ab anybody jo subsidy maangne aata hai, like, you know, there are ways to route it, we can talk about it, but the fact is, private limiteds don't have subsidy. They have accelerated depreciation. So, please be very upfront. Anybody in this room who is talking to private developers, please do not kill the industry by saying subsidy to private players. Please. Aap apna bhala nahi kar rahe ho, sabka satyanas ho raha hai. That's, there may be some unscrupulous players, unfortunately, are the bad eggs in the basket, bad apples in the basket, which keep on going and telling people subsidies lwa denge, mere paas pehle ki padi hai, mere paas sekki ki padi hai, mere paas uski padi hai, kuch nahi, bakwas hai. So, be very upfront, very confident, there is enough documentation available to say there is no subsidy for private limited companies. Please. If the person is still hell-bent, phone number deta hon, Prasad ji ko phone kare, usko wahan se MNRE se khud turant mil jayega. Theek hai na? Have that attitude, be very sharp. Aur aapko, in the sense, you are, More ji, you are a salesperson. Aapko to bechna aata hi hai. So in the end of the day, battery is battery, we have what we have. Do haat hai, do pair hai. Kaam to chale gai, I mean, it's still a lot of improvement. Solar, when I started selling, and Shubhra, when you started manufacturing, buying for 150 rupees a watt. Now what, 26 rupees a watt, 27 rupees a watt? Kaan chal le raha bas, 30 rupees a watt? So we've got a lot of advantages. So wo roda do na band. Aage wala ro raha hai, to agle customer pe jaiye. That situation has improved. In off-grid also people are understanding that. So, at least for Mumbai people with high-rise buildings, no mercy.
Sir, I am Ashok Kumar Datta from Ranchi, sir. One of the off-grid solar applications is solar cookers, which is zero maintenance, zero operating cost, and lot of food values, delicious foods. But it is unfortunate, I find that it is not popular at all. Is there any efforts that can be done or any innovations can be done so that it becomes very popular and it will be beneficial to the country?
No, I am not going to say anything more because I already had long discussion on this topic with Mr. Das. So he was actually interested to hear from someone of you whether you have any views on that.
Hello, sir.
I think in terms of the view, I think it is something that we should definitely propagate. And I think the problem that solar cooking is having is developing a correct business model which can be help, which can commercialize the product. At least from our perspective, the product is nice and feel it seems to cook well. Khichdi is amazing in this. But the problem is that the business model to sell and the supply and distribution for that was very difficult. So it's one of those products which have been around for a long time. There is an installation in Mount Abu which is really making excellent, yeah. So that's all we can say in our perspective. I think if anybody in the audience or anybody can come up with a strong business model which can ensure that solar cooking can happen, then people like us will love to take it up.
Hello, sir. Myself, Rishi Patel from Lucknow. And sir, I am doing independent research in the field of solar inverter. And I made a custom design in which we can play just like if we want to increase some type of power from 1 kVA to 2 kVA, we can just plug and play some modules to increase the power level. And we divided each module just like a charge controller and a DC to DC unit, AC to AC unit, and all other units in modules. And they are just like to plug and play. सर इससे मुझे फायदा ये हो रहा है कि मैं अपने कस्टमर्स को मतलब बहुत फास्ट सर्विस दे सकता हूँ. अगर कोई मॉडल में प्रॉब्लम आई है तो इंडिकेटर से साफ इंडिकेट हो जा रहा है कि आप कैसे इसको सॉल्व करना है और अनट्रेंड से सर्विस दे सकते हैं. तो इस तरीके के मॉड्यूल्स को सर हमने सिमुलेशन पर टेस्ट किया है. मैन्युफैक्चरिंग में टेस्ट करने के लिए हमें कहाँ जाना होगा, इसके लिए हमें क्या करूँ?
How do we go into manufacturing and testing?
No, you can collaborate. So, I mean, this is a general... I was saying this is a very good question because it opens up a Pandora's box of general problems India has in supporting entrepreneurs. There is
obviously lack of prototyping and design for manufacturing capabilities in India. But you want to test your inverter, is it? Inverter kahan pahuncha hai aapka? Abhi matlab chal raha hai kuch hai ya fir paper pe hai?
Sir, maine simulation design, even MATLAB.
Abhi simulation hai. To badi dikkat hai. तो मैं बड़ी सीधी सीधी बात कहता हूँ, मैं अभी लखनऊ का ही हूँ, अन्नाव का ही हूँ, बड़ी सीधी सीधी बात है, जब तक कुछ बनेगा नहीं ना, बिजली निकलेगी नहीं और आप दिखा नहीं पाओगे पैनल के साथ, तो कोई कुछ नहीं कहेगा.
तो सर उसको टेस्ट करने के लिए
वही है, यू हैव टू मेक इट. बट यू आर टॉकिंग इज अ स्टेप ऑफ इनोवेशन. देखिए अब शुभ्रा मैडम के पास आप जाएंगे, बढ़िया प्रोडक्ट लेके जाएंगे तो वो बना देंगे आपको. बट द क्वेश्चन इज दैट हाउ डू यू मेक समबडी इंटरेस्ट. अनफॉर्चुनेटली व्हाट समटाइम्स व्हाट्स डन इज यू कुड गो टू लाइक दीज आईआईटीज ऑफ द नेचर. जैसे एक आप आईआईटी चेन्नई ट्राई कर सकते हैं, तो रूरल बिजनेस, रूरल टेक्नोलॉजी बिजनेस इनोवेटर, प्रोफेसर झुंझुनवाला जामिया में भी है. सो लुक फॉर प्लेसेस वेर यू कैन. बट एवरीबडी विल आस्क यू, यू विल सी योर इनोवेशन वट एवर. इफ इट्स जस्ट ऑन पेपर तो बड़ी दिक्कत है.
नहीं सर, इन पेपर एंड ऑल द कैलकुलेशन, आई मेड ऑल द कैलकुलेशन एंड सिमुलेशन आर रनिंग वेरी परफेक्टली.
तो बनाने में दिक्कत क्या आ रही है? कॉम्पोनेंट्स नहीं मिल रहे.
We need to contact some industries where are the equipment are available to manufacture, because a PCB layer are designing in 2-3 layers. So how can we can?
आप बैंगलोर जाएंगे? बैंगलोर जाएंगे पूछ रहा हूँ.
Yes sir.
ठीक है, आप मेरे से बात करिए, बैंगलोर भेज देंगे. मतलब बनना चाहिए एक महीने में.
Sir, we can try.
ठीक है. Components मिलने में क्या दिक्कत है? I mean, do you have a problem getting components? Do you have a problem getting components?
We're not a product company, so yeah. Honestly,
so but I mean, I can tell you this way, like it's not an issue. I mean, India has enough manufacturing base. I don't know about UP mein nahi hai, Bangalore side, Pune side, there is enough component guys, but you have to go with the value proposition to these people. Kya value hai? Madam ke paas jaiye zarur jab ready ho jaye.
Hi, thanks everyone. Arjun Mehta from Solar Town. I'm a captive EPC player myself. My question, I would like to bring another angle which hasn't really been discussed very much over the last couple of days, on social value and CSR in India. Now, with the 2% CSR law a couple of years old now, and with the law having mandated rural solar, solar water heating, solar pumps, irrigation through solar, and you know various other schemes as well, you know, within the CSR law, has that business model been explored, perhaps even exploited by young entrepreneurs at this moment? And if that's a no, is there a possibility of it, or are there any hurdles in implementing that CSR funding from the corporates who are profitable into such ventures which actually are a part of this particular law or allowed by this particular law? Thanks.
I'll take that. So obviously we have experience and you know, I think every year we probably end up deploying projects worth about 1.5 crore to 2 crore through the CSR route. The challenge there is obviously the sales cycle there, and you know, for us, while for them it's a CSR spend, for us it's a sales cycle, right? We have to have a compelling proposition for whoever is the decision making authority at whatever company we're looking at. The sales cycles are very, very long because there is no sort of mandate or there are no pressures or implemented you know, targets for the CSR spending, you know, when it comes to some of these corporates. In fact, my you know observation has been that as of right now, because this law is still fairly you know young and you know implementation is an issue, that most companies are typically working, you know, trying to work their way around the law in terms of you know deploying their money for in directly or indirectly using their own products or offerings or whatever they might have. But yes, you know, it would be wrong to generalize, and there are companies, you know, which are, you know, very, very proactive, and we've worked with a ton of them. But it's almost like, you know, every sale will probably, the cycle will stretch on for 2-3 months of conversations, and the moment you sort of, you know, let it slip up, because, you know, for them, obviously, they can, you know, deploy their money across not just, it's not just energy for them. It's, you know, it could be education, health, sanitation, and a whole host of other things, you know. So there are limitations there. So I don't know if that model will be very scalable. Again, because of the plethora of you know choices, and you know you don't end up competing with other solar offerings. You end up competing with offerings from other segments altogether. So it's just at the end of the day, you know, extremely competitive.
No. I'll just say we also have a few crores worth which comes, but unless you have a very strong relationship with a particular company, cracking the CSR through general marketing is stupid. Doesn't happen. You, because CSR is generally delegated to somebody who they don't want to put an in division. So that person or that lady is basically talking to you for months. She has no understanding what you do. And it keeps going on, and you really don't have the patience. And the fundamental problem is then your consumer and customer become two different person. So we get a microgrid laga dijiye, but hamara board bhi hona chahiye, you know, bahut bada. And then board ke upar na ek light laga dijiyega. And boss, unke paas light nahi hai, tabhi microgrid laga rahe the. Agar aapke board mein light lena ho, to aur ek microgrid lagana padega. So there is a very big disconnect between CSR and these our companies like ours, which are fairly technical. So we lose patience very fast. So unless you have a very beautiful relationship, like your father knows his father, and there's a beautiful relationship, your wife's married to this, great, go for it. Low hanging fruit. But don't waste time, boss. Go to the field, you'll be able to sell faster. That's my thing. And I know you guys do excellent work, by the way. So I'm sorry if I said anything against anybody who loves to have a CSR model. Hopefully we'll meet again next year.
Yeah, my question is to Kartik. Are you selling the solar pumps or renting them out?
Renting model, which is essentially, you know, what we call as irrigation service, is still, I would say, at best at a pilot stage only. See, what happens is obviously with the advent of all these subsidy programs that exist out there right now, it distorts the market. And yes, while renting in some ways, works its way around these subsidy programs, which are oftentimes ill-designed, but it requires a whole host of other, challenges that need to be worked around. For example, how do you identify, the genuineness of a customer? It's an expensive asset, should there be a default, or should there be a default in payment, or someone's trying to act cocky? How do you repossess the asset? How do you redeploy it somewhere else? How do you ensure that you collect the money, on time, and so on and so forth? So it's doable on paper. It makes tremendous sense. And we're working towards it, but as a young company with limited resources, we've only been able to go that far. That said, we are actively working on a pay-as-you-go model for irrigation, and it's deploying the first couple of hundred systems under that, but nothing at scale as of right now.
Good afternoon, panel. My name is Kurt Johnson. I'm here from Los Angeles, California. I work with a company called Diversified Global Energy, and I'm just very fortunate to be here at this presentation because it just turned out very synchronistic that I happen to work in this industry. And anyway, we have a hybrid fuelless generator that produces 525,600 kilowatt hours annually, and are looking to unroll it into the Indian market. But one of the challenges that I'm just trying to understand is perhaps how best to bring it out into a private sector or to approach the government, finding a path of least resistance into providing clean, green baseload power to rural communities that can be monitored by exception via satellite. It's a brand new technology, but I'm really, I've spent years in India, and I've spent a lot of times in a lot of villages and places like this where they just have no access, and that could have a tremendous industrial base in a green way. But just trying to figure out, perhaps if you could give me a couple words of guidance into which way to go. I have some nice contacts, but I'm not really sure which way to proceed first, government or an actually energy producer, or if you could have any guidance, I would really appreciate it. Thank you.
I'm actually not the right person, but I'll try to do it. See, I think I've seen most foreigners who are working in off-grid areas getting successful in two areas. One is Africa, and second is in Indian conditions. It would make sense if you could make your own project and put up a demo or a pilot system. There is no point convincing other people, government, private, etc., about it and then going through them. They'll distort the entire project. If you have spent so much time, it would make a lot of sense to raise a grant or raise a something where you could put up a pilot project and you could showcase that project to other people. And I think that would be the way to go. Otherwise, getting a project out of a private entity from a CSR fund or from a government entity is going to be extremely difficult. That is what my take is.
Yeah, so Chris, welcome to India from Los Angeles. I went to school in Irvine, which is about 60 miles south of you. It's very hot here. Don't go to the government, please. At this stage where you are, if you're just starting up, you'll obviously have great conversations, and if you enjoy that, fine. But if you want to sell, it's probably not the best idea. I completely agree. At first, you'll have to spend, put your own skin in the game and show demonstrable results. Saying that, though, that if you feel that you have something of value, project developers are fairly open now, based on people who want to upgrade their technology or, for example, increase the capacity in a way. Again, it depends on the product that you have. So it would be nice if you engage with project developers as well. But you'll have to show tangible results to them. And in India, please remember the money and the cost is the most important thing. So if you have a reasonable optimized pricing which works, that would make sense for project developers. Or if you can provide them the capex as well. So a lot of companies which are coming in are also coming in with an investor. So they're engaging project developers to sort of build and sort of do an EPC for the thing. But they have, the risk is not taken over by them. It's a fairly risk-averse area. And the government is probably the most risk-averse. So, thank you.
Thank you. No, that was great.
Yeah, my two cents here would obviously be, as a company which is not married to a technology provider yet, and unlikely to sort of do so in times to come, we typically evaluate technology offerings from across the globe, and invariably we found that it's very, very hard for us to place enough faith in a product, especially when we know that that's going to be deployed in the kind of settings that we work in, which is very, very remote and rural and far flung. So just to give you my personal perspective, I would definitely want to see your skin in the game in terms of having deriving some comfort from the fact that yes, you are invested here in terms of being around long enough to provide whatever support is required on the product side, whether it's repairs, replacements, all of that. And that confidence building obviously will happen with time. I can also assure you that if the product has merit, there will be a ton of companies which will deploy it even without thinking too much, because there will be some government program which probably might create some little window for you, for them to push in a product offering for you. But I don't think that will be long lasting at all. We've had like $1 billion Japanese companies trying to come into India and sell their solar pumps, started off working with the government, spent 2 years, pretty much got nowhere, then worked their way around and said that okay, we need to work directly with the private sector. And there also, we were very, very tentative in terms of, ensuring that they had the manufacturing footprint, the service footprint. If something goes wrong, let's say in Patna, five, 300 kilometers from Patna in a remote village in Bihar, do I really have to spend more money than what the solution or the product itself was worth to get it to Delhi and, repair or replace it? I think those are the decision-making drivers for companies like us when they're evaluating product offerings like yours.
Thanks so much.
I think we are already overshooting, sir. During the tea, you can always discuss that out. Yeah. So with that, I would like to thank all the panelists. In fact, the beauty is that, and that's, I always find that when I am with young people, it's always, I'm very hopeful and that I see a lot of opportunities which are taking place. So it's always very positive experience, and that's what they also conveyed, that they are very hopeful about the whole sector or the subsector, as we say it. So with that, I will request you all to give a big hand to all the panelists. Thank you very much. Thank you.